स्थापकाय धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय द एस्टैब्लिशर ऑफ द इटर्नल रिलीजन द एम्बॉडीमेंट ऑफ ऑल रिलीजन्स एंड द बेस्ट ऑफ ऑल प्रीवियस इनकॉर्नेशंस वी सैल्यूट दी. इन द लास्ट क्लास We read up to page number 144. Today we are going to continue the reading from page 145. Chapter 3rd, the first manifestation of the attitude of a sadhaka. The book name is Ramakrishna, the Great Master. So here we have been reading about the sports, the spiritual sports of Sri Ramakrishna in his life. All the incidents in his life are considered as the spiritual sport of the Superman, this incarnation of God. So we start from para number 2 on page 145. Chapter 3rd, the first manifestation of the attitude of a sadhaka. It is not true that every one of the wonderful events of the Master's early life, which we heard has proved the manifestation of his divine power as he passed into high planes of consciousness. Although some of them were of this nature, we may classify the others into six broad divisions, namely, those indicative of his wonderful memory, of his strong power of judgment, of his steadfastness and strong determination, of his infinite courage, of his love and of merriment, and of his unlimited love and compassion. But purity, selflessness and unique faith were found running through all of them. It looks as if his mind was naturally made up of faith, purity and selflessness. And the various actions and reactions of the world in it gave rise from time to time to waves of memory, judgment, determination, courage, merriment, love and compassion. The reader will have a correct understanding of what we say when we give a few examples here. An example of his wonderful memory. There had been in the village a theatrical performance on the theme of Rama or Krishna's life. Many people, including Gadadhar, had witnessed it. All of them forgot the songs and the sacred words of the Puranas the next day and were busy following their own selfish ends. But there was no end to the waves of spiritual emotions produced by them in the mind of Gadai, that is Sri Ramakrishna. The boy assembled his friends in the neighboring mango grove in order to rehearse them and enjoy the bliss thereof. He made all his friends get by heart as far as possible the parts of different characters of the drama that they had already witnessed. And he took the part himself, the leading role, and began to enact the drama. Simple-hearted cultivators ploughing in the neighboring fields were charmed to see that play of the boys and wondered how, after hearing them only once, they could get by heart almost all the words and songs of the play. It is an extraordinary memory. It is called in a Sanskrit word, Yeka Santagrahi, one who can retain by hearing only once anything. Yeka Santagrahi. So Sri Ramakrishna had that power of hearing once and retaining it for all his life. It is said Swami Vivekananda had also that power. And almost all the yogis, they have a great power of memory. At the time of his investiture with the sacred thread, another example is of strong determination. At the time of his investiture with the sacred thread, the boy persisted against the custom of family and society that he must have his first ceremonial alms from a blacksmith woman, Dhani by name, or charmed with her affection and devotion, and being aware of the desire of her heart, the boy forgot the restrictions of society, snatched curry, sauce, etc., cooked by that woman of low caste, and ate them. In great fear, Dhani forbade him to do it, but could not make the boy desist. He did not care for caste or creed. He wanted only devotion, which Dhani had in plenty. Later on, he is going to make a great statement saying the devotees have no caste. Devotees of every religion, they are devoted to God. Devotees of God belong to a separate class. They don't belong to any of this class or creed or caste or any sort of compartmentalization in the usual societies, both in the East and in the West. At the fear always arises in the minds of the boys of towns and villages when they see Naga fakirs with their matted hair and bodies covered with ashes. Here is another case where other boys were afraid of Nagas. This Gadadhar was very fond of them. There is a belief current everywhere in Bengal that those fakirs, Naga fakirs, entice young boys, or when opportunity arises, they abduct them to different places and add to their own number. Groups of such fakirs and vairagis, people who have renounced everything, travelled daily in those days by the path to the south of Kamarpukur, leading to Puri Jagannath, the abode of Jagannath. They would come to the village, beg their food, rest there for a day or two, and then start for the destination. Although Gadai, his friends, remembered the tradition and were frightened at the coming of these Naga fakirs, he was not a person to be afraid of this. He mixed with the groups of mendicants as soon as he saw them and pleased them by his service and sweet conversation. He used to spend much time with them in order to observe their conduct and behavior. Requested lovingly by them, he took on some days the food offered by them to the deity before he returned home and told it to his mother. Desirous of being dressed like them, out of love for the holy men, he one day put on the tilaks, the marks on the forehead, all over his body, and tearing a new piece of cloth given by his parents into kaupina and loin cloth, wore them in their fakir's fashion, and came to his mother. This, of course, frightened the mother. That is another story. Here that we were telling about the courage of this boy, where all others of his age were afraid, but he was so intimate with them, not at all afraid of them. Examples of his love for merriment. He is known as an incarnation of joy. One great writer has written, Sri Ramakrishna was an incarnation of joy. Holy Mother told about him, I used to see a smile on his face even when he was in Samadhi. So some of his disciples of Holy Mother, they asked her, how can be one smiling when one is in Samadhi? He's completely out of the body. Body cannot express anything. But Holy Mother simply said, whatever may be your theories, I have seen even in Samadhi also, smile on his lips. So he was the incarnation of joy and merriment. So that is being discussed now. Many of the people of the low class in the village did not know to read the Ramayana and Mahabharata. When they had a mind to hear those books read out, they invited a Brahmin or one of their own class who could explain the epics to them. When that person arrived, they offered him water to wash his feet, a smoke of tobacco, a good seat to sit on while reading, and lacking this, a new mat. Honored thus, he swelled with pride and egotism. He also belonged to their community, so with so much of honor being offered to him, his soul swelled with pride and egotism. Fond of merriment, and the keenly intelligent boy, Gadadhar, observed how he occupied an elevated seat before the audience, and how many were the odd gestures and tones with which he read the books and displayed his superiority to them. All this the boy would sometimes mimic before others with a grave face, which would give rise to great fun and peals of laughter. So he was full of merriment. So he would make others also full of joy and merriment. Natural constitution of the master's mind. By a study of these facts, that his courage and his steadfastness and his love for common people, compassion, all these things, as study of these facts of the master's early life, we realize the nature of the mind with which he was equipped to undertake spiritual discipline. We feel that such a mind could not but accomplish whatever it undertook, would never forget what it heard, and would at once throw away mercilessly whatever it came to know to be an obstacle in the path to realization of its desired end. We realize that such a heart would perform all actions in the world, placing firm reliance in God, on itself, and on the divine nature hidden within all human beings. No ideas having the slightest tinge of narrow-mindedness would be acceptable to it, let alone mean impure ones, and love, purity and compassion alone would regulate. Regulate it all the time in all matters. It will also be realized that no idea, either within his own heart or within those of others, would be able to deceive him by disguising its nature. Before proceeding to study his sadhanas, the spiritual practices, we shall be able to understand their uniqueness if we closely remember what has been said about the constitution of his heart and mind. The first manifestation of the mood of an aspirant. I will learn not the art of bundling rice and plantain, but that which produces right knowledge. So this is one of the themes of his life. He wanted education to give you eternal, lasting joy and peace, not earning a few chips of gold or silver, or getting some comforts of this physical life. So that was a philosophy all his life he followed. So that idea is being discussed here now. We see the first definite manifestation of the attitude of an aspirant in the master's life. When he was in the brothers' school in Calcutta, Ram Kumar's school, it was a Sanskrit school, so he was there living with his brother. On the day when Ram Kumar, his eldest brother, admonished him to apply his mind to the acquisition of learning, to which he clearly replied, "I do not want to learn the art of bundling rice and plantain. What I do want is to have that which produces right knowledge and enables man truly to achieve the aim of his life." Aim of his life always, you will say, God realization. and realization of infinite life and infinite joy. So he wanted the education to lead to that, not for merely earning something of this world. He was then about 17 years of age. Knowing that there was little chance of his education progress in the village school, his guardians consulted one another and brought him to Calcutta. His religious-minded eldest brother, well-versed in astrology and the Indian Puranas, Smriti, had started a Sanskrit school near the house of the late Digambar Mishra, a rich man at Jhamapukur in Calcutta, and was teaching some pupils. He took charge of the daily service of deities in some rich families of that quarter, besides this Mitra family. It took him most of his time to give lessons to students after finishing his daily religious duties. Therefore, it proved very difficult for him, that is Ram Kumar, elder brother of Sri Ramakrishna, in a short time to go twice daily to different houses and perform the service. Nor was he at the same time able to give it up hastily, for the income from the school by way of farewell gifts was very small and was daily decreasing. How could the household affairs be managed if he gave up what he was receiving as fee for the service of the deities? Weighing these ideas in his mind, at last he brought his youngest brother to Calcutta. That was the idea, that Gadadhar was brought to Calcutta so that he can get some more time after entrusting some of the duties to Gadadhar. He can make some more money to help his poor family. Placed him in charge of the service of the deities and applied himself to the work of teaching. So this is how Sri Ramakrishna was engaged after coming to Calcutta to his brother's house. On arriving at Calcutta, the master's activities at the Jhamapukur toll in Calcutta. So what did Sri Ramakrishna do? We are discussing that. On arriving at Calcutta, Gadadhar got his favorite work and performed it with pleasure. The worship of deities in different houses, so that he always loved. So when he loved a work, it was no work, it was a joy. That is how they say also, if you don't require any holiday, if you get a job of your own choice, you like the job, you don't want holiday. Only we want holiday when the work becomes tedious and cumbersome. But when you love the job, you would not ask for a holiday. The more holiday a government or a state sanctions mean, the people are unhappy with their work. Their work ethics has not been properly developed. So it was the case with Gadadhar. He loved worship and that came to his part as his duty. So he performed it with pleasure. Besides serving his eldest brother, he also studied a little, very little, just to pacify his elder brother. Possessed of noble qualities, the pleasant-looking boy became dear to all the people in a short time. What had happened in his village, Kamarpukur, the same thing happens in Calcutta also. Everyone starts loving him. The veiled ladies of the respectable families of this place, even like those of Kamarpukur, did not feel any hesitation in appearing before him when they became acquainted with his smartness, guileless behavior, sweet conversation, and devotion to the gods. They were eager to get some odd jobs done by him and to listen to his devotional songs. Here also, as in Kamarpukur, the boy became a center of attraction of a group of loving people round him without any effort on his part. Whenever he had leisure, the boy met those men and women and joyfully spent some time in their company. Therefore, it is clear that the boy made no better progress in his studies even in Calcutta. Although Ramkumar observed this, he could not suddenly mention it to his brother, for he had already deprived the mother's dear youngest pet child of the pleasure of her affection and had brought him far away practically for his own convenience. So he was a very conscientious person. For my selfish interest, how can I deprive this 17-year-old young boy so much attached to his mother? But he had brought him for his own purpose. So he felt the conscience for that. So he brought him away practically for his own convenience. Should he, over and above that, put obstacles in the way of the boy's enjoyment, when attracted by his noble qualities, people were lovingly inviting him to their houses, and the boy too felt happy at that. So he could not stop him also. And if he did so, would it not be the life of the boy in Calcutta become unbearable as in a forest? If there were no wants in the family, it would not have been necessary at all to take the boy away from his mother. It would have been enough if the boy had been sent to some village nearby the Kamarpukur to study under a learned scholar. In that case, the boy might have been with his mother and been educated at the same time. Although Ramkumar did not complain for some time on account of these considerations, still urged by a sense of duty, he admonished the boy mildly one day and asked him to apply his mind to studies. It was a difficult job for him to interfere with the merriment of this boy. So charming was the person, and he was so young also, almost 30 years younger to him. So he was just hesitating. One day perforce, he just had to admonish him. For some day, he thought, this simple-hearted, self-forgetful boy would have to fend for himself if he did not now learn how to guide himself on the path leading to the improvement of the worldly affairs. Could he be able to do so in future? This is how Ramkumar thought. Therefore, it is clear that brotherly love and worldly experience moved Ramkumar to act that way of admonishing his younger brother. Ramkumar's ignorance of the nature of the brother's mind. Why Ramkumar? Almost all, everyone was ignorant of the wonderful genius of the mind of Sri Ramakrishna. Although he had fallen into difficulties arising out of the selfish, harsh ways of the world and acquired some experience, the affectionate Ramkumar did not know much of the extraordinary nature of the mind of his youngest brother, Gadadhar. He could not realize even in his dream that, young as he looked, the boy could detect the cause of the lifelong labor and efforts of the worldly man, and knowing ephemeral fame and enjoyment to be worthless, could fix a different aim for human life. This young boy, he fixes a different aim for life. But the whole world is saying to make good whatever time you have, energy you have, to make money, wealth, name and fame, and then pass away. This is how this usual person, common man, thinks he is very ordinary, very normal. So everybody thought like that, but Sri Ramakrishna thought other way. It is useless to acquire name or fame or money or wealth or anything. All things have to be left behind. Everything becomes zero. So it is useless. What should be done? Acquire the love of God, acquire the vision of God that is eternal for you. You will get eternal life, eternal joy, eternal knowledge, eternal power. That is the thing worthwhile doing. The goal of life is God realization. That is how he preached in future. So that attitude of him could be seen in all his activities even then. He could not realize even in his dream this young boy could think like that and could fix a different aim for human life. Unmoved by the rebuke, when the simple-hearted boy told him the thoughts of his heart in the above-mentioned way, I don't want the plantain and rice bundling education. The priests, you know, usually, in the villages, even today, towns also you can observe, when the priests come, so whatever is offered, along with that one, some rice is offered, some vegetables are offered, fruits, etc., along with money, etc. So at that time, perhaps money was not much given, and other gifts were not available. So only rice and some fruits and vegetables used to be given. So Gadadhar referred to that. I don't want that education by which you bundle up rice and plantains. Plantains means bananas. So he expressed it that way. He could not comprehend his words. Ram Kumar could not comprehend the depth of his words of the younger brother. He thought that the boy, a pet of his parents, was piqued or annoyed at being thus scolded for the first time in his life, and had therefore answered him in that way. That day, the truthful boy tried his best to explain to him the thoughts of his heart. He expressed variously the idea that he did not feel inclined to go in for a breadwinning education, which our present education is. All our present education is breadwinning education only. At that time also breadwinning education was there, but there were people like Ramakrishna who would point out this breadwinning education is useless. God-winning education is always welcome. They were there. We want such people today also to advise our people for a good education where perhaps only God realization cannot be practiced. So at least practice for God realization also some spiritual practices and do the worldly duties and take worldly education also to prosper in the secular world. So this is how the present education also requires what Sri Ramakrishna told at that time. That day the youth tried his best to explain this one. But who would listen to the words of the boy? He was after all a 17-year-old boy. The people who were before him were 30 years, 32 years, the elder brother himself was so far removed from in age from him. So other people were much older than him. A boy is after all a boy, they thought. If even a grown-up person is seen to be above selfish effort, we solemnly declare that his brain has been deranged. The people were so selfish and so small in their thinking, so shallow in thinking, they used to think even a matured person, if he goes in only for worldly prosperity, and if he does not go in for worldly prosperity alone and devote some time, some greater time for spiritual practices, they would call him not natural. So they used to call him, he may be slightly going towards insanity. So when that was the condition, if the 17-year-old boy, when he says the goal of life is not money making, it is God winning, it is realization of God. So who would believe him? So naturally, all of them thought it is just he has told something which perhaps he himself does not understand. That day, Ram Kumar did not understand those words of the boy. Moreover, just as when we chastise an object of our love, we repent in the next moment and trying to regain our peace by loving him 100-fold more than before, so also Ram Kumar behaved with his brother and for some time after this. That means when we are harsh on the youngsters, we feel in our conscience that we have done wrong to that boy. So we call him again and show greater love so that we can wash off the pain we have dealt with him. So similarly, Ram Kumar also started loving, are showing love more to pacify him for this hurt he had done to him by admonishing him. But when we see the series of Gadadhar's actions, one after another, we get a clear proof of the fact that since then he was seeking an opportunity to fulfill the desire of his heart. So Gadadhar, so he was not pricked with conscience, because what he told was what he thought as truth, what he taught as his conviction. So he had expressed it. So he was continuing in his own way. The worldly condition of Ram Kumar, and between all this conversation, admonishing him, trying to bring him into his line of worldly thinking, the life of Ram Kumar was going on in a way that is being told to us. The current of events, the life of Master and his eldest brother flowed a little fast during the next 2 years after this event. The pecuniary condition of his brother, financial condition of his brother, was daily deteriorating. And although he tried in various ways, he could not improve it. He pondered much in his mind whether he should close his school and take to some other job. This is somewhere in the 1830s it is happening. But he could not come to any decision. He could clearly understand in his heart of hearts that if he spent his days that way, instead of soon adopting some other means for the management of the worldly affairs, he would be involved in debts and consequently suffer. So the only way was, if he had to earn to meet the needs of his family. If he did not earn, then we have to borrow. If you borrow, you become a debtor, and it will be perennial trouble for you. How will you repay? So there is a tremendous problem in his life. But what means was he to adopt? He was an orthodox man, great scholar in Smriti, and great scholar in Hindu law, and then astrology also, and a Sanskritian. So much of qualification, the British government and the European culture that had come into our country. How many such great people were thwarted in their life? We cannot imagine. This is one case we are learning about such a pious, wonderful man, how he was put to financial difficulty and his whole life became bitter. So what was then, what could you do to earn money? He was not able to earn money with the knowledge that he had. A new knowledge of some technology, some engineering or something, he had to learn at that age if he had to make some money. For he had not learned any other occupation than those of teaching, performing sacrifices and officiating in them. So that was his professional. The profession he got as an inheritance from his father. But that had no value in society for that. Nobody cared for sacrifices or for religious rites and rituals. And had he the energy and perseverance at this period of life to make an attempt to learn some lucrative profession suited to the times? See, that great man has been put to difficulty thinking like this. Again, even if he did acquire an art of that nature and try to earn money, it would surely be difficult for him to get time to perform worship and his daily religious duties also. So the present day rat race for jobs is, we do not know the psychological impact on the people who go for jobs which starts at 9 o'clock in the morning and ends at 9 o'clock in the evening, leaving them no time for any other pursuits other than making money. And any other pursuits include the worship of God, worship of some rituals, some traditional puja, etc. If they don't do it, they will not get mental peace. For that also they have no time. In the modern time, it is there. What was there in 1830s, it is continuing here. So he could not, he thought, if I take to some modern technology and making money, then I'll have to give up even this small worship of gods, which is giving me mental peace and joy. So how can I go for a new profession? So deciding to let Raghuveer shape his destiny according to his will, he turned his mind from these thoughts and continued to do with a broken heart what he had been so far doing. So he could not come to any conclusion. So he continued to teach in the school, though he was getting very little money in return for his services and earning a meager thing against a big expenditure. So he continued this way. For we think Ram Kumar, who had great faith in God, was content with a little, and being good-natured, was not very pushing in worldly life. So these are all the greatness of a sattvic person, a saintly person, but that had no money value. So money, it could not fetch him money. So he was considered practically as a failure in practical life. And there now occurred, by the will of God, an event which showed Ram Kumar in a way out of that uncertainty and relieved him of all anxiety. So he had resigned himself to Raghuveer, God Ramchandra, family deity. So now the family deity brought him an opportunity to get out of this financial difficulty. What happened? So we take up in the next chapter, chapter 4, the Kali temple at Dakshineshwar. The cause of Ram Kumar's starting the toll in Calcutta, the date of the starting. So this is almost like a research paper on Sri Ramakrishna's family members and different events of the whole family. So we are starting now. Why did Ram Kumar come to Calcutta? What were the difficulties he had to face? So etc. will be discussed here. Probably Ram Kumar was 45 when he started his toll. Toll means the primary school. Toll in Calcutta, of a Sanskrit language. So Sanskrit language at a primary stage or a middle school stage is called a toll. So he came to Calcutta to start a toll in 1850. He was about 45 years at the time. Worldly wants, mishaps, etc. had caused him anxiety for some time past. His wife died after giving birth to her only child, Akshay. It is said that the Sadhaka Ram Kumar predicted the death of his wife and said to some members of the household that she would not survive the birth of the child. The master had then reached his 14th year when Akshay was born. Many rich and middle-class people lived in the wealthy city of Calcutta. Ram Kumar could remain free from worldly anxiety if he could make the students of the school proficient in learning. So he thought perhaps the students would give him enough fees so he can manage his worldly affairs. Or even the students, when they grow older and take up their jobs out of faithfulness to their guru, they may come and help him also. So he thought starting a school would do good to him. That was one of the reasons he argued. Ram Kumar could remain free from worldly anxiety if he would make the students of the school proficient. He could perform religious worship and give written opinions on religious matters because he was an expert in astrology and smritis, which would fetch a few additional rupees. Some such thought was perhaps instrumental in bringing Ram Kumar to Calcutta. When he was mourning the death of his wife, you see, it was a time for mourning, but the financial difficulties were so much, he had no time to mourn also for that beloved soul which had departed, leaving him behind in the earth, his wife. He had no time to mourn for her also. So what a sad situation he was in, we are learning now. It may be that at the death of his wife, he felt a great change and void in his life. And the idea that he would be free from them to a certain extent if he were engaged in various works in a far off place like Calcutta made him take up that course. That was also one of the reasons he came to Calcutta. We have told the reader earlier the purpose for which he brought the master to Calcutta a few years after the inception of the school at Jamapukur, and the manner in which the master spent the first 3 years after his arrival there in AD 1852. So 1852, Sri Ramakrishna was 16 years old. So at 16 years old, he came to his brother. For 3 years, he was living with him. And one of those days, in the 3 years, he got his admonition also. So this is how the history of the family is being told. We must turn our attention elsewhere if we want to know the events of the master's life since that period. The reader must now direct his attention to the series of events that were taking place by the will of God in a very well-known family in another quarter in Calcutta. At that time, Ram Kumar had enrolled himself in the party of Chatu Babu in order to increase his income from farewell gifts and improving the condition of his school. So he was in the effort to get out of this financial difficulty. At that time, something was happening in the family of Rani Rasmani, Mathurma, Mathurnath Vishwas, and all that. So we are coming to that story now. Rani Rasmani. The famous Rani Rasmani lived in Jan Bazaar in the south of Calcutta. She is famous, Rani Rasmani, only not after coming to Sri Ramakrishna. Early in itself, she was very famous. We are going to learn about it. This lady, though coming from a low caste of Kaivartas, had tremendous genius in her of management of great big estates. So she, not only managing the estates, she knew how well to spend the great incomes that were coming from the estate. So about that Rani Rasmani, we are going to learn. So the famous Rani Rasmani lived in Jan Bazaar in the south of Calcutta. She was the mother of 4 daughters and became a widow at 44. She inherited the huge property of her husband, Raj Chandra Das. Since then, she had managed it herself and improved it much and had thus become well known to the people of Calcutta. She became famous and endeared herself to all, not merely by her ability in managing the property, but also by her innumerable other virtues and good actions, such as her faith in God, her energy, courage, intelligence, and presence of mind, and above all, her sympathy for the poor, expressed through her increasing gifts and unstinted distribution of food to all, annadan. So she became very dear to all the common people also. By her noble qualities and actions, she, although born in a Kaivarta family, proved herself worthy of her appellation, the Rani. Rani is queen, so she was called a queen. It was her name also, Rani Rasmani. Rani Rasmani was the name, full name. But that Rani also means queen, and she actually, by her virtues, had become queen. So it means both her original name also and the position she earned through her own hard labor. So, although born in a Kaivarta family, proved herself worthy. The Rani had attracted the heartfelt love and reverence of all groups of people, irrespective of caste. Usually the lower caste were not, even though they were great, the upper caste, they never attributed that greatness to them. But she was one person whom everybody revered and then praised her for her great talents. The Rani's daughters were married and had children at the time we are speaking. When Sri Ramakrishna was 16 years old, then the Rani had already 4 daughters married, and they had 2 daughters married, and she was there. They were all living independently. Then the 3rd daughter of the Rani had died and had left behind only a son. Thinking that the said event would estrange the debonair Mathuranath, her 3rd son-in-law, from the family, the Rani married her 4th daughter, Jagadamba Dasi, to him, who was the son-in-law for her, by the 2nd daughter. So third daughter died, so she married the 4th daughter to the same son-in-law. So that to retain the same son-in-law, because that son-in-law was also an extraordinary person. He helped Sri Ramakrishna in so many ways. Sri Ramakrishna was also very highly appreciative of his tremendous courage, tremendous way of management of huge estates, and his faith, tremendous faith in Sri Ramakrishna. Whatever Sri Ramakrishna would ask, immediately he would be there present with those things. So Sri Ramakrishna also loved him. This extraordinary person, Rani did not want to lose. Therefore, after the 3rd daughter's death, she offered the 4th daughter as his wife and retained him as her son-in-law. So these things were all taking place alongside of Ram Kumar's life on one side. The descendants of the 4 daughters of the Rani are living till this day. The Rani's devotion to the goddess. So this Rani, she was very devoted to Mother God, that is Mother Kali. So her devotion was so great. So one incident is being told here to reveal the greatness of her love for Mother Kali. Endowed with many virtues, Rani Rasmani bore great devotion to the holy feet of the goddess Kali. Sri Rani Rasmani Dasi, longing for the feet of Kali, were the words engraved in the official seal of her estate. You see, in the official seal, it was engraved, Sri Rasmani Dasi, longing for the feet of Kali. That means her devotion. So on every letter she would send out and she would put the seal. So people, by just seeing the letter without opening, she would understand the person who has sent this letter is a great devotee of Kali. So she was so much devoted and she loved Kali. We have heard from the master himself that the Rani's devotion to the goddess was expressed in all her words and actions. The Rani, it is said, had cherished in her heart a long time desire to go to Kashi and pay obeisance and other special worship, offer special worship to Vishveshwara, Vishwanath, God Vishwanath there, the Lord of the universe, and Annapurna, the Divine Mother. It is also said that she had collected and set apart a vast sum of money for that purpose. So, in this new chapter starts, it was this Rani who is going to erect the great temple of Dakshineshwar for Kali, and then where Sri Ramakrishna is going to become a priest, and the whole the spiritual sport, the divine sport of Sri Ramakrishna will start. So we will take up that part in our next class. निरंजनं नित्यमनंत रूपं भक्तानुकंपाधृत विग्रहं वै ईशावतारं परमेशमीड्यं तं रामकृष्णं शिरसा नमामः. ओ रामकृष्ण द टेंटलेस द इटर्नल द इन्फिनिट ऑफ द इन्फिनिट फॉर्म्स हु हैज अस्यूम्ड फॉर्म ओनली आउट ऑफ कंपैशन to the devotees, the incarnation of God and the adorable Supreme Lord, we salute you with our heads down.